if you just look at into any organization, like they do have this whole data ecosystem, right? So it's spread all over the place. So, you know, if you don't have a process defined, let's say like if you would like to have an access towards a DB, right? For any of the tasks which you would like to carry out, right? So what the typical process here would be like, you will go to the person who know, like you will, you know, just like you're going to send them out an email saying, hey, I would like to have access towards this, you know, this particular DB for my, you know, for whatever the thing which I'm going to build it up. So he's going to, I mean, the person who received the email now is going to take the request, and they tend to find the right person in the company who should it rise to. And from there, it's like the whole process is going to be like, you know, it's going to be it's a long process, along with the time and the effort to actually get you what you wanted is going to be, you know, it can be plenty of time. And by the time you're going to deliver the use case, or by the time you want to build that use case, it's going to be pretty late, right? So you don't want this to happen, and you know, all of this, there is also other problems back in the organizations where, you know, you do have a lot of you know, data ecosystem. I mean, like you do have a data ecosystem, but you don't know where it's residing, who to contact, to what is the process involved in getting the access towards the data for consuming. I mean, like, imagine like you do have an organization and you got, you know, like trillions and quadrillions of data sitting on the bare metal, right? So if you don't know how to leverage the data for whatever, you know, the you know, whatever the end goal which you're trying to accomplish, I would say like if this is something to do with building up the data warehouses, you guys may be hearing about the phrase data warehouse, right?
Right.
Yeah, so if this is something to do with a data warehouse, or if you want to build a data vault, or if you want to build a data mesh, these all things is whatever we're trying to build up with the data architecture. We had to make sure, like, you know, we have a single source of truth, and we should be knowing where the data is residing, and also how to grant access to the data. All of this, you know, the questions with regards to the data, we should be addressing it at one place, and also the process involved in getting the access to the data, right? All of these things should be in one place where, you know, we can so easily consume data for whatever the end goal which you're trying to do, right? So this is why, yeah, this is why we have the whole governance on top of it, right? Of the data ecosystem what you're having in the organization. And also imagine you'll be in a scenario where imagine like a developer, you're having a company, let's say that's being listed in the Fortune 100, right? And you invested so much on the resources. You hired a person so much on the resources, and this guy is, you know, this guy is so good. He's getting the whole process going, and he's doing everything beautifully, right? And this is, we don't have a data governance in the house, right? So we have everything going. And imagine like tomorrow he's going to have a better opportunity somewhere else, and he's just going to, like, you know, he's just going to say, hey, like, you know, he's just going to hit up you and say, like, hey, I got a different opportunity out in the market. So, you know, I would like to take up the opportunity, right? So you will be in a scenario where, you know, he knows most of the information to build your company, and the way the architecture is being built up, the whole lot of information about how your company is being structured with regards to the data ecosystem, he will be the whole sole person to know about it. And imagine like he's going to leave the company one day, right? So that is going to have a huge impact, right? On the you know, the ROI of the person, and also on how the rest of the things is going to be carried out within the organization, right? So there is a lot of questions with regards to the leaving of that personnel from the company, right? So imagine we have a process, or imagine we have a way of documenting, right, of whatever he is trying to on a day-to-day basis, right? So whatever he's trying to do, whatever the knowledge he's having, whatever the things which he has built, everything, imagine like we have captured on a tool, and, you know, we all could leverage it, right? And yeah, so even if that person is going to leave the company tomorrow, you're still not stuck. I mean, like, you do have, like, you know, at least 90% of the information, right? Whatever he used to build the whole ecosystem. I mean, the clients which I have worked with in the past, what I have identified is like, you know, they tend to say, you know, like their data architecture is really complex, and they build like 10 years back, 12 years back. I mean, you know, even the client which I work right now, you know, like they tend to say, like, you know, they have this the database system set up back 12 years back, right? So and that person is no longer with the company, right? So they are really afraid to make any changes to the architecture itself, because they don't know how that is going to have an you know, how that is going to have an impact on the rest of the things, right? So they wanted to put the governance on top of it, right? So there is a whole lot of process going on to identify who is a subject matter expert here who could pitch in some. Yep, go ahead, Michael.
What size company are you talking about where one person is like responsible for the data then? Because I'm working for companies that are, you know, huge, like multinational things, and there's a data governance team of a dozen people.
Right. Right. So I this is again a hypothetical situation, right? This is an actual company. But to answer your question, there is a whole lot of heavy lifting with regards to, you know, some work with regards to that is being assigned to a fork, right? So imagine like he's going to disappear one day. I mean, typically it's not going to happen, but like if you have some offer, there is like, let's say like that do happen, to be frank. It's not one person, I would say like, you know, at least a person at the higher management level who manages everything with regards to the data architecture and how that is being defined, what are the different structures and all that kind of stuff. Imagine he's going to have a different opportunity in the market. Nothing is stopping him to actually move from the place. And again, here we'll be in a place where, you know, finding the right replacement, trying to analyze and trying to do. There is a lot of investment again, like it's going to be a repetitive process of what he tried. We'll be trying to capture what he's trying to do, right? So we have to put again time and investment to actually identify this kind of thing. So that typically is going to be a really a bottleneck for most of the companies out in the marketplace. So that's why this is one typical use cases. There is a lot of other different use cases which can actually, you know, be solved on top of Collibra, but this is again documenting, right? This is the right phrase maybe which I have might have missed out, or I was trying to come into the picture, documenting what you're trying to do, or like the whole process that is being involved, and, you know, documenting each and every single asset, the process involved. This is going to add a lot of value towards the company and the you know, the people and the process that is actually leveraging that. Okay, so this is very critical, right? So we getting all of this information captured, documented. Collibra, I mean, if you just have a look at the Collibra from the very high level, just always have this thing, always get into your mind that like it's more of a documenting tool, metadata documenting tool. That's what I call it, right? Data without the metadata is pretty much, to me, it's meaningless, right? To add the meaning to any data, we definitely need to have that metadata in there, right? So Collibra is pretty much more of a metadata documenting tool, right? Now, so if you could just look at the screen. So this is a typical, you know, definition you'll be finding out in the Google, if you just Google for what the data governance is, right? So I'll give you more of a what it is from the very high level. So if you just want to get down or drill down to one or two couple of definitions of what it is, then it is what it is. So data governance is a collection of processes, roles, policies, standards, and metrics that ensure the effective and efficient use of the information in enabling an organization to achieve its goals, right? So this is the standard definition, right? So I mean, you have already worked with a lot of other data governance tools in the market, and you know some of the tools which is very prominent or evolving is something which I have mentioned in here as well as an example. So Collibra is one such. BigID. I don't know whether you guys heard of BigID. You heard of BigID or?
I think I have. Yeah.
Yeah. So that also has the heavy lifting of, you know, that tool also has heavy lifting of data governance plus data privacy plus you know, there's a whole lot of other things you can do on top of the BigID. But yeah, and we do have Overledge. That's another data governance tool. Informatica, that is something that you have worked with, right? Informatica Exxon. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So yeah. So all of these tools have that capability of delivering the data governance solution, right? So now I just put up this slide because, like, you know, some folks, even after going through that definition, they might be still lost of, you know, like, why we need that definition, right? So that's why I brought up this example here. So you do see a pet bottle. You can see my screen, right? So I just brought up a different slide so you guys can see my screen.
Right, we can see a screen.
Yeah, okay, right. Thank you for confirming. Yeah. So imagine you have an organization, right? An organization, we don't have a data governance on top of it. We just, like, it's so distributed, right? So it's all over the place. And imagine, like, you would like to get access to a database for XYZ activity, right? And again, there's a lot of questions with regards to that data source which you're going to connect to leverage the data set, right? So that would be pretty much, you know, it's so distributed, like, you know, we don't know where there is a different replicated data outside of whatever the department you're working with, or is the right data source which you are trying to leverage to actually pull in those information, or there's a lot of, you know, the trust factor within the data source which you're trying to access to, or how often that is being updated. There is a lot of questions. Or do we have some sort of other data sources where we could leverage on top of it as well to actually make it more user friendly or user to deliver the use cases of whatever you're trying to consume, right? So that's pretty black box if you don't have that ideas, and if you don't have all the kind of information, right? So that's why I just put up this image of, you know, an empty bottle, right? Or just imagine a scenario. This is a hypothetical situation, right? I'm just going to come up to you, Dolapo, and I'm just going to offer you just, you know, this bottle. I know you're thirsty, right? I'm going to offer you this bottle, right?
Yeah.
Imagine, like, are you going to drink it from it? Definitely no.
No, I'm like, I don't know.
Hell no, right? Yeah. Hell no, right? Yeah.
Even though you won't pay for it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, paying is one thing, but imagine, like, you know, you don't even know me, right? It could be anything. It can't be, yeah. It's not necessarily, it could be water, right? Now imagine you go to a shop, right? And you have a place where you can actually buy the bottle. And imagine, like, you have all of these, markings, right? When I say marking, the government marking, there is some sort of, you know, all the standards, and you have a full documentation of where it's being manufactured, how it's being manufactured, what is the company that is being manufacturing these the pet bowls with the distilled water, and you have also of this information, right? This is gonna add the extra level of trust. Now imagine, like, you know, you go to the shop, right, and you have this bowl. You don't know, I mean, like, where that is being manufactured, but you do have all of this information within the label. And, you know, it's pre-sealed. It's a trustable place where you can actually buy that from. This gives you that extra level of confidence to actually consume that bowl, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So if you just, right. Yeah, if you just try to map this with the same, same data ecosystem is as well, right? So you have something that is very black box or very, very opaque as what we have on the left-hand side as this bottle, because again, the only thing we will be lacking there would be the trust and the conception of that data, the data set or the data, right? The data itself would be out of a question, right? So there's a lot of questions that needs to be answered, right? Imagine you have a data set that is being certified. Right, there's a process of certifying that we'll come to that right down the line. Imagine, like, we have a certified data set that is being, you know, that is being used by so many different you could say let's say any of the BA tool, right? Let's say Power BI for that sake. So imagine, like, Power BI is actually leveraging some of the data set, and we have a proper certification for it. We know who the stewards to get to if there is some sort of problems with regards to the data set, and who been using that data set, all of these questions, right? So we have all of that answer documented in Collibra, if you're able to leverage Collibra as the single source of truth to document all of the data set information and all the data source information of search, right? So the gap and the trust, it's, you know, the trust, you have very very high trust of that data set, also the gap would be reduced. So, like, you know, you could very well, you know, use that data set for your end-to-end activity, right? Yeah, so the structured data, right? So when we talk about structured data, it's pretty much a database or, you know, a CSV file or Excel file or all that kind of things that we call a structured data, because we do have a structure towards it, right? Correct. So that's called structured data. And how we capture the structured data, I mean, you always have to, like, think about any, I mean, you do have a lot of data governance tool in the market, but when it comes to Collibra, the thing which always has to put on top of your head is, like, we're not going to bring in any data to govern it. It's all about the metadata, right? So it's all about the metadata.
What is a schema exactly?
What is a schema? Right. So, okay. So imagine you have, if there is one place where, you know, just imagine, like, you go to a database and it's all over the place. It's not structured. It's all over the place. You have a lot of different tables and columns all over the place, right? So that doesn't make any sense, right? We have a structure of what tables and what columns has to be within. You could see it as a container, right? A container where you have all the relevant tables of whatever the use case is, what you're trying to build up. And you have...
Okay, it's just like a house for the databases.
It is what, sorry, to the databases?
Like a house for the databases.
Yeah, I mean some data, you know, some databases, they typically, you know, they don't have schema. If you just look at the SQL Server, even though they claim to, like, you know, if you're just trying to catalog the stuff in the Collibra, even though they do say, like, they have schema, but in the real ideal scenario, you don't have actually a schema for SQL Server. And again, the things how they are doing that is actually a bit different. But if you just look at the Snowflake, how they have distributed is actually through the schema level. Like, you do have, like, multiple schemas and multiple tables along with it. So you could say it as, like, a different containerization of things, of structuring of things, where, you know, you're gonna put all the relevant tables and all the tables and views that is going to go along with whatever the use cases you're going to work with into one single umbrella. Hmm. Right now. So we have this is the structured data, right? So you always have this thing on top of your head. So when it comes to this distribution of things, right? So structured data, very important. And in Collibra, We don't bring in the data. It's always the metadata. There has to be certain use cases where we have to work with the data. And again, this is sample data. And down the line, some information would be, like, very PII, right? So there is a lot of policies and a lot of, you know, things that goes around this data element and how we are going to deal with it, right? So there's a whole lot of process, right? So you mentioned, like, you have a social security number, right? And, you know, even if it's sample data, right, getting into the tool wouldn't be, I mean, you should be really concerned about who's seeing it, how he's been seeing it, and what are the different, yeah. So we do have something called roles and responsibilities. This comes in the stewardship model of the people, which I was talking about. I told you about the three pillars, right? People, process, and technology, right? So when you look at the people, so we have something called stewardship in Collibra. And if you further break it down, roles and responsibilities, right? Mm-hmm. Right. So we can allocate roles and responsibilities, and we can also allocate the view permissions to who can see the sample data, who can't see the sample data, right? But it's typically, it's better to have a different process where we're going to mask all of that PIA related information. Right. So the masking is very critical, because again, it all depends upon what sort of business you're into. If it's like a healthcare related business which you're into, then, you know, there is a lot of rules and regulations you have to comply with, and you need to identify what are the different PIIs and how you could just, like, you know, how you could mask it, or how, I mean, there's different process of how you're going to build something on top of it, right? So this is something, all of this sort of visualization, you can have it in Collibra, right?
Right.
Okay. Now, the semi-structured data. This is more to do with the, you know, when you say semi-structured, it's more of XML and JSON. I guess you guys might have seen an XML and JSON file, or
I've seen JSON and XML. Well, XML, yes, a lot. Yep. JSON, yeah, too.
Yeah, good. How about you, Michael?
No, I don't think so.
Right, you haven't seen. Okay, right. So XML files, it's we call it a semi-structured data, right? So, let me see if I can pull up an example of XML file here. Oh, you can see my Google search, right?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So, the image is a bit all over the place. Right. So there you go. So this is a typical example of, this is an XML file. So you have different nodes and data, you know, different elements, and like it's being grouped in such a way. And, Collibra has the capability. I mean, we have to know how we can actually, you know, catalog this information into Collibra, right? Some tool on the market, they do have this Metastore. I mean, Metastore is pretty much, something where, you do have some data that needs to be written on top of whatever the tool which you're working on, right? Imagine like you have Data 360, for example, which you have worked with. Data 360 may be using some sort of Metastore to actually store its metadata information. So every single time you're going to log into the tool, you're going to have that, where you have left before, you're just going to have it, it's going to resume where it is, right? So you're going to have all of that information in there, right? So this is pretty much called the data Metastore, right? Mm-hmm. So it can be some tools back in the days, they used to have it, they used to have XMLs, they used to, whatever the metadata they're trying to store, it would be actually stored in the XML format, right? And just for your understanding, so back in Collibra, our Metastore is PostgreSQL, if you heard of that database, PostgreSQL, yeah. So back in the Collibra's Metastore is this PostgreSQL, and that's fully being controlled and leveraged and managed by Collibra itself, right? So yeah, so right.
So, so this is a question on the Metastore, because I see that a lot. What's the Collibra Metastore again?
That's PostgreSQL.
Oh, okay, all right.
Yeah, PostgreSQL.
What SQL did you say? Sorry.
Postgres.
Prosperous.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, PostgreSQL, right? So that's your Metastore to actually store. So every single time you log into Collibra, you have, you can work from where you have left off. You have all of this information, right? You don't want to redo the whole thing. That's pretty much like caching, if you have heard of this term, like if you just go to this browser and if you just type in something, if this is something which you have worked with, like it's going to pull up all of that information back into you, right? So you could try to map it something similar to that, but it's not exactly the same, but you can map it something similar to that. We have a persistent storage in the Metastore. It's not going to go away.
Good.
Okay, good.
Yep.
Right. So JSON, have you seen an example of a JSON file before, Michael? Or
no, I don't think so.
Okay. Let me just pull this up. Right. So this is a JSON file. So in the JSON file, how they would in the JSON world, what they call this is objects, right? Whatever the curly brackets within the curly bracket, or we call it keys, and we have something called objects, right? So an object can have multiple keys and values, and there is array of objects. There's a lot of different ways we can organize stuff in the JSON, right? So this is an example of a JSON file. Again, this is a semi-structured file, and most typically, if you just worked with any of the APIs or REST clients or something like that, typically they have this response and request in the JSON format. Yeah, so this is this. Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead, Dalab.
I was just going to say, you know, the way I've seen it uses for the old ETL process,
mm-hmm.
you know, trying to establish connectivity. Well, we're using it to ingest data from a data source into, well, metadata into Collibra.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I've seen it used before.
Sorry, ingesting metadata to Collibra. I just lost the last bit there. The lab, can you?
I just said that's how I've seen it used. That's what I was saying.
Okay. Good. So you have some exposure towards Collibra. That's good, right? Good. Now, so that's all the you know, the semi-structured data is all about, right? And we come to the unstructured data. So the unstructured data is, you know, this can be a bit tricky how we're going to document it, right? So we have, you know, an example of some of the unstructured data here would be an image file, right? Maybe a text file or any file of such, right? So this is where, you know, you mentioned like you do have a data lake, right? You're going to put all of the files into these data lakes or pictures or videos, or, you know, you can just put a lot of things into this data lake, right? So again, if you don't know where it is, how it is being used, where to be used, all this kind of information, and if you don't have a process defined, like, you know, the data lake can be data swamp down the line, and we don't want that to happen, right? So for that, we had to make sure we have a governance on top of it. So this is all about that unstructured data, right? Text file, image file, audio file, video file, all of this kind of chunks is unstructured data,